And let me now also share the PowerPoint. So to introduce myself again, my name is Diane Kaufman, and I'm coming to you actually from my home in Portland, Oregon. I work in Hillsboro, Oregon, and this is the Arts and Healing Resiliency Center. We are a safe haven for expression and self-creation. And today's special event is called Nurturing Poetic Narrative for Post-Traumatic Growth. And I'm going to be your facilitator. The inspired mission of the Arts and Healing Resiliency Center is to honor and practice the caring art of human connection, which I hope we will be embodying today with each other. This bird painting is something that I had done at a process arts workshop. Originally, I had titled it Bird of Prey, /Bird of Prey, P-R-E-Y. But then years later, I re-understood it and renamed it, and I called it Phoenix Bird Rising. And Follow Your Arts Heart has been an online gathering since September 2021. And we've had expressive arts workshops, a salon, a gathering of people together, and also a studio online to do our creative work together. Becoming our unique and best self is a lifelong, life-enhancing and life-giving art. Arts expression and thoughtful reflection in a caring community nurtures resilience. Creativity illuminates the darkness. It may not take away the darkness, it'll transform it, but it illuminates it. Creativity is the ability to transform what was into what still can be. And here are some of my reflections as an artist. Creativity is the lifeblood that beats my heart, and I yearn to express and create from life. So this is Pegasus, the winged horse, child of Medusa. The backstory of the myth is that Medusa had been raped by Poseidon, the god of the sea, sort of Athena. And Athena, unfortunately, did not get angry at Poseidon, got angry at Medusa, and cursed her and made her tear into the snakes. And anyone who would look at her would get frozen. What eventually happened was that her head was chopped off, and out of a full-blown Pegasus. Pegasus is the combination of the horse and the bird, and is the symbol of poetry, creativity, transformation, and some say is par excellence a symbol of recovery from trauma. Now, today's special event is dedicated to Amelia Dawn Coffman, and I think it may be emotional that this presentation, not just a presentation, it's a memorial. And some of you who've been in the Follow Your Arts Heart previously may remember Amelia. Amelia always joined us from her van. She was traveling cross country. And I always share this image, which I'm going to show to you next, with a few questions and writing prompts when we meet as a group. And Amelia had been inspired by it. And, oops, sorry, let me go this again. And that is the image. It's actually a photograph that I took on a walk around Portland, and I sort of personified it and labeled it, "Don't be afraid to be yourself." And then each time we would meet, I would put a different writing prompt on it. And this one that I pulled up says, "To the world, does one rose matter?" So I would like us to begin by your writing or drawing your response to that image and words to the idea of, does one rose matter? And when Amelia had seen that writing prompt, what had gone with it was, what is the dream of the rose? So if you like, you could respond to, does one rose matter? What is the dream of the rose? Or anything that perhaps was inspired by looking at that image. I'm going to join you in writing, and we will come back again and share, those of you who would like to share what you've done together, okay? And I'll give you a warning as when we will soon be completing that exercise to go on. So we'll do this for another minute, and then we'll do some sharing. So would anyone like to share what they wrote? You would need to unmute yourself, but you're welcome to share if you'd like to.
I'll share.
Wonderful. Thank you, Paige.
I just kind of wrote, well, I drew a little picture of a rose, and that's also been my favorite flower as of recently. I felt connected and drawn to the rose. And I'm not sure why, but I'm very visual, so I just drew a little picture. I'm no artist, but I just jotted, it's fun to just draw for me, so I just did that. And then I was just thinking as I was drawing about one rose being, I thought it's reminded me of saying, of asking the same question of, does one person or one gesture, one person mm-hmm. matter to the world? I kind of translated into people.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, what I would probably, even though I don't feel that way, that like I always matter every time, I would probably tell somebody else that they do, that that person matters, that one person matters. So I would say that I think, yes, of course, that one rose would matter to the world because every little thing matters. And one rose could possibly be beautiful enough or strong enough to illuminate that darkness in the world that I've been noticing a lot lately. Like, I mean, I struggle with certain things here and there, and I've just been noticing a lot of darkness in the world, and I don't know why I notice that. Just like overhearing arguments or witnessing road rage, or I've just been seeing a lot of that mm-hmm. darkness. And
Paige, do you want to show us the drawing that you did?
Okay, it's this with my pen.
That's okay.
Let me see if I can.
Yes, oh, I see it. Yeah.
Okay, it's just like with a blue pen, and I don't know how to draw roses, but it's all folded together, and it's just the ridges are all together, so it looks like, you know, my goal was to make it look texture with the 3D kind of look. But like I said, I'm no artist. I do love roses, and I think that they symbolize something really beautiful that I don't know a ton about roses, but I do been drawn to them lately, and
I'm going to ask you right now the page that we're going to go on, right? And
okay.
And thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
And if anyone else wants to share what they wrote, because at this point I'm going to go on a bit, you're most welcome to put it in the chat as well.
Okay.
So I want to share with you Amelia's response to the flower. Okay. So here's what her writing, here's her cane, and this is what she wrote. I woke up today and my feet refused to carry me. Would you like your cane or the walker, she asked. My emotions sour. I want to go back to a time when I didn't understand that someone in her 30s could need to ponder this question. But I pushed outside into the hot sun, and as my legs struggled, as my soul struggled, I saw this singular rose jutting far outside of an otherwise barren rose bush. Mm. It was so absurdly far from the rest of the plant that any gardener would have pruned it without a thought, maybe kind enough to let it live its last days being enjoyed in a bud vase on the kitchen windowsill where the morning light filters through. Yet, it isn't dying on the sill. It's out there, still alive, wild and out of order. Wrong, yet perfect, alive. Amelia declares, yet it isn't dying on the sill. It's out there, still alive, wild and out of order, wild yet perfect, alive. And I'm wondering, do Amelia's words resonate with you? Why or perhaps why not? Would anyone like to comment on that? Having listened to a bit of what she had written on seeing the image of that flower. So if not, or you can put your response into the chat, I'll go on. Amelia emailed me her out of order poem on June the 18th, 2022. And she also wrote, I'm a resilience researcher, which is how I found your group, and lost my PhD in social psych and health with a completed dissertation and coursework, but before I could defend when I got sick in 2018. It's been a rough few years of loss on top of loss, and I'm just coming back to my creativity again as I rebuild. I'm quite sure I'll see you again. And she was right. We did see each other again in the group. And this is what I wrote back to her the same day. Thank you so much, Amelia, for sharing your writing, perfectly imperfect, as it were. Here's the flower I saw today and showed in that group. My flower is saying hello to your flower. I'm so glad Follow Your Art's Heart was like air for you. I hope you return to the group again. In 2017, Amelia presented Yay, It Makes Me Stronger, Finding Resilience in Our Fear and Uncertainty at the Contemporary Relationships Conference in Houston, Texas. Here's that video. So I'm going to play that video for you because it has value in helping us understand brokenness and post-traumatic growth. Okay, so let me find now the video, okay? So I can play it for you. So this video, we're meeting until 2:30 or maybe a little after 2:30. This video is about 30 minutes long, but I'm sharing it for a purpose because it has to do with resiliency, trauma, growth. And I've shared this sound, but I'd appreciate people giving me a thumbs up just to let me know that they can hear it, okay? Oh, and this is like an advertisement. No, maybe it isn't an advertisement. It's people at the campus. Sorry.
I can hear it.
You can? Good. Thank you.
Yeah, I can hear it.
Yep.
And here, this is Amelia.
Good morning. Welcome. So when I started my PhD in social psychology, this has been a few years ago now, my degree, my concentration is in psychometrics, which means that I'm supposed to make questionnaires, like a questionnaire for depression that a therapist could give to a client and they would know kind of how depressed that person is. So I was learning the kind of statistics you use to do that. So I had to make a questionnaire and I said, I really want to make a questionnaire about resilience. So for 2 years, I researched resilience, everything that there was to know about resilience. And right before my second year of school started, my advisor said, hey, Amelia, can we take a walk outside? It's never good when your boss asks you to take a walk outside. But she just said, this is a really complicated topic, and you've researched it admirably, but there are people still fighting about whether to say resilience or resiliency, and you don't want to be in the middle of that. And I think this is not a great thing to make a questionnaire about. So maybe pick a different topic. I did, it worked out fine. But all of that 2 years of research has been sitting in a box in my storage room. So one reason I wanted to give this talk is to not feel quite so bad about paying the university $30,000 for a box in my storage room. Another reason I wanted to talk about resilience is that the past year for me has been pretty difficult, and I had to draw back on some of those things I learned during that 2 years. And another reason is that I actually was not supposed to be here talking to you today. I'm part of the program committee for this conference, and so I was aware that just a couple of months ago we had a presenter cancel. And the reason that that gentleman canceled was that he was coming across the border from Canada, and he emailed us and said, I am Muslim and I'm part of the LGBT community, and some of my friends who are just Muslim are really having trouble getting back and forth across the border. And I don't want to be detained and not show up for your conference at the last minute and do that to you. And I also don't want to be detained going home and do that to my family. And so regretfully, I'm going to have to cancel my appearance at the conference. And in a lot of rooms of people, that would be a pretty shocking thing to hear. In this room of people, I don't think it is, because as part of the LGBT community, we deal with things like that on a really regular basis. And so also in honor of the gentleman who is not able to come and present today, I wanted to talk to you about resilience. So in your program book, I said that resilience means bouncing back from something hard, which is true. I did lie to you a little bit, though. So when something hard happens and you get sort of thrown down, you can bounce back not quite as good as you were. You maybe can bounce back to where you started out, and that would be good and admirable. But some people somehow bounce back to somewhere higher than they were before the hard thing happened. And so that is what we're talking about with resilience. It's not that you just bounce back to where you were before that hard thing happened. It's that you take that hard thing that happened to you and somehow put those pieces back together, and you become something greater than you were before the brokenness. Everybody has times where, you know, life knocks them down. Everybody has times of brokenness. But think about how your life would be if next year, when you got really knocked down by life and had a time of great brokenness, you didn't just bounce back to where you were, but you were actually able to use that time and become something better, not in spite of that brokenness, but because of it. So when we talk about resilience, we think about flexibility. We need to be flexible to be resilient, which is true. But if I had like a plate of Jell-O here, Jell-O's pretty flexible, and I tipped it out on the floor, it's not really gonna go well. They told me I wasn't actually allowed to do that on the carpet. So you have to use your imagination. So the sort of opposite of being flexible is being really strong. We learned a really hard lesson about being strong as a country and as a world, kind of in the early to mid 1900s. We started to learn that we could make really hard steel by adding more carbon to it. And so we had this new, really strong steel, and then we could build bigger things. So we started building really big bridges and really big boats. And then this strange thing started happening where bridges that had been built for 2 or 8 or 10 months collapse, brand new bridges, and ships that were brand new broke in harbor. This is a picture of the SS Schenectady, broken in half. This ship was brand new. It had been in the water for 16 days when this happened. 16-day-old, very large and expensive ship, and broken in half. So there's some problems with being strong, and we learn that as a country and as a world through these sort of things. There's a really interesting thing that you can make out of melted glass, and it's called a Prince Rupert's drop, if you've ever heard of that. So basically you drop melted glass into cold water, that simple, and let it cool off, and it makes this little tadpole thing out of glass. But it's actually a really interesting thing. This is an incredibly strong thing. So you can hit it with sharp hammer things and it won't break. You can shoot it with a bullet and it won't break. Incredibly strong, right? But if you so much as touch the end of it, that little tiny tail, the entire thing not just shatters, it explodes. And yeah, pretty crazy. And that's because in increased strength, you're almost always going to pay a price in flexibility. So in order to be resilient, you really have to find a little bit of a balance between strength and flexibility. So we could say that resilience means sort of finding that balance and through that being able to recover from things that happen. We don't want to, you know, be able to withstand really hard things but be vulnerable to very small things, but we don't want the opposite of that either. This is the Mackinac Bridge. It connects the two peninsulas of Michigan. The bridge is long enough that if you ran down and ran back, you would almost have run a half marathon. It is a long bridge. And I drove across this with my parents when I was fairly young. And even my parents were a little bit scared because on this bridge, you can feel driving the motion of the bridge. And the bridge has to do that to be able to withstand the vibrations of the cars, the wind. And it's a little scary how much flexibility it has, but it needed that flexibility to be strong, to not be one of those bridges that collapse after 2 months. So we're finding that balance of strength and flexibility. There is a guy that does a lot of research in the sort of resilience things. He has a really cool process model. It's in this article. He's also published the same model in some other articles and papers. So I kind of wanted to go through all of that with you today. So we sort of start here as a person. I actually want to maybe explain this a little bit differently. Okay, so this is better for us. So we'll do it this way. So this is sort of where the cookie wants to be. It wants to stay in between these lines. And the cookie is happy when it's in between those lines. And all the time, there's sort of stressful events trying to break the cookie, pressing down. And the cookie is sort of trying to protect itself. In human beings, those protective factors are things like being physically healthy, having social support, believing that you have some control over your own life and what happens. So there's always this sort of balance going on. But sometimes in our lives or in a cookies, things are going to be too overwhelming and the cookie's going to get broken. And so I want to sort of go through that process of what happens in our life when we get to a place of brokenness, because we know we're all going to experience those times. So if I'm making cookies to take somewhere and my cookies get broken, then I go, okay, what am I going to do? I have to take cookies to this event tonight. And you have to sort of put the pieces together. We have to reintegrate in some sort of way. So you start getting the sugar and the flour and the oil and all your cookie making stuff together. And you have this big mess of stuff on the table and you go, okay, I don't know that that was really helpful. And that's the point where you go, I'm just going to go to the store. But you've got to figure out what to do from those pieces. And I want to actually stop here and look at just this part on the bottom a little bit more closely, and then we'll pick back up in the same place. There are a number of theorists who talk about the need for disintegration in order to have growth. It's a pretty popular theme in psychology, even apart from the resilience literature. One of those people is George Lann, and he has this idea of breakpoints. The theory is transformation theory. And he said, any time that you are growing as a person, as a business, anything, you're going to have times where you start out and things are going kind of slow, and then you have a decision to make that hopefully will lead to a lot of growth. Maybe a company is coming up with their ideas and making their logos, and then they start selling things and they start really growing. Good. But then when growth is really going fast and you're feeling really good about things, there's always a second breakpoint. If you think about a company that maybe they've been making everything out of their garage and shipping things out in the morning before breakfast and handling everything, and they get to a point where the company is big enough that they can't do that anymore, and they have to make a decision. Are we going to keep doing what we've always done, and the company is going to eventually go out of existence? It's going to kind of plateau and then go away. Or are we going to find a way to start doing things differently and through that grow? That's why you see companies on Shark Tank. They're right at that breakpoint trying to figure out what to do. And you notice if you take that growth choice that's starting to go up, it's going to be another one of these S curves, that it goes down at first. And that's pretty difficult when you're at that point and you say, okay, I'm going to make the choice that I know is different and new and scary. And then you make that choice and things get worse. But that's sort of how that cycle goes. It takes a minute to adjust to the new decisions that you've made. So if you've ever had a relationship end, if you've ever had a loved one pass away, if you've ever lost your job, then you were at one of those breakpoints and you had to make a decision about, do I keep doing things the way I've been doing things, or do I make some kind of change somewhere? Incidentally, in psychology, we talk about two kinds of stress. Distress would be, you know, if someone passed away, you lost your job, a relationship ended. But we also talk about eustress, which is good stress. Eu is kind of a prefix that means good. So eustress would be things like, I got married, I had a baby, I got a new job. And those are really positive things generally, but they can be just as stressful as the negative things. We're actually running a study right now looking at that. And the sort of problem with the good stress, the eustress, is that if you had a baby and you're supposed to be really happy and doing really good, but it's really stressful, it's not always okay to say, oh my gosh, I'm falling apart a little bit right now, because you had a baby, you're supposed to be happy. And so they are pretty equally stressful, but it's not as socially acceptable to talk about the good stress. But both of those, and they can be happening at the same time in different ways. So over time, we have one after another of those curves with the breakpoints in them. And at each time, we have to say, am I going to keep doing what I've done and sort of disappear in a company sense, or just stay stuck where I am in a personal sense? Or am I going to keep choosing to do things differently, to tolerate that low spot, and then to keep moving through it? And that's sort of where you see people who are in a really resilient place. They deal with those hard things in that way. So back to our cookies. So we have cookies for an event tonight, but we have no cookies for an event tonight, and we have to figure out what to do. In a personal sense, we are broken. Something just happened, small or large, and we're in a place of brokenness. And we have to decide, what do we do with that place of brokenness? And we have, in general, five choices. The first is fairly simple. We can just stay where we are. This would be called a choice of stagnation. We can say, I'm just going to really settle into this place of brokenness. It just is what it is. I can't change it. I'm just going to stay broken. There's nothing I can do, so it's okay. And I guess the benefit of that is that you don't have to work too hard. The bad part is you stay broken. And broken can start to feel normal if you stay there too long. We have a sort of worse choice even than staying broken, and that's that we can just make things more broken. In a personal sense, that would be pushing away what happened. That could be through something like drugs or alcohol or gambling or an eating disorder. It could be through just denial of what's happening. I'm not broken. I'm just fine. Nothing happened. I wasn't hurt. I'm not hurt. It could be cutting certain people out of our life so we don't have to deal with what happened. We just say, it's that person's fault. I'm not going to be in their life anymore, which can be sometimes a healthy choice, but often not. And so in that way, we're not just broken. We're really, really broken. And typically when we're in that place, we don't notice, we don't feel the brokenness because we're too busy dealing with other things. So it's not an ideal place to be. And often if you're, you know, going downhill from the brokenness, that takes a little bit of help from a friend, a clergy, a therapist, somebody like that. We can go up a little bit and we can say, well, I kind of put the pieces together, but if you pick the cookie up, they're going to fall apart again. And so we could call this reintegration with loss. I've put the pieces back together, kind of, but they're not whole. They might look whole to somebody on the outside, and I might be trying really, really hard to look okay to people on the outside. But on the inside, I still feel pretty broken. And on the inside, now I have to sort of struggle against those two identities of feeling broken on the inside, but having to show on the outside that I'm doing fine. Everybody ever been there? Yeah. I think it's a pretty easy place to go. Then we have another option, which is, I'm just going to come back to where I was. I'm going to work through sort of those stages and get back to where I was. And so in our cookie sort of example, we could bake another batch of cookies. Now we have whole cookies. We could go to Kroger or whatever and buy some cookies. And then things are pretty okay. We have new cookies. There's some big problems with that in our own lives. One is that we've just thrown away a lot of time and effort that we spent making the first batch of cookies. And in our lives, emotional time and emotional effort can be really valuable. And to throw it away can be difficult. And that can create a whole nother sense of brokenness that has to go through this cycle. Another problem is that we might be throwing away some really good things, not just time and money, but those broken pieces might hold some really valuable things that we might really be wanting. And so if we're missing those pieces now, we've thrown them away, now we have our whole cookie back, but we've missed a big part of what made us ourselves. Then there's one fifth stage of that. I don't know if you can see this back in the back, but these are little Cookie Monster cupcakes with broken cookie pieces to make the cupcakes. So now, instead of just saying, I'm going to be what I was, I've used that brokenness that I experienced. I've taken these pieces and not made just new cookies. I'm not just taking cookies to the party tonight. I'm using those broken pieces to take something even better to the party. And that's what we can do with resilience. We can say, I'm not going to throw away these pieces because the time it took me to make those cookies is valuable. I'm throwing something away that I could use to make something even better. and I'm going to choose not to do that. And it might take me a little while to stare at these broken cookies and figure out what I can do that would be better than what I started out with, because our mind doesn't naturally look at broken things and go, oh, this is awesome. I'm going to have the best cookies ever tonight. My mind doesn't, at least. I go in a little bit of a panic mode. It's not a natural thought process for most of us, but it can be a really helpful one. I don't know. Anybody prefer to take broken cookies to the party now? Looks it look a little bit more attractive. It's not an easy place to get to. It is a place you can get to from the brokenness. And this whole cycle, you know, typically you're not just gonna jump to the Cookie Monster cupcake. You're gonna have to work through those levels a little bit. And if it's something really little that's happened, that might take you a couple hours or a day to work through. If that's something really big that happened, that could take months, a year, multiple years to work through. It might take help from somebody else, a friend, a therapist. It might be really difficult to work through, and that's okay. And of course, our life is not as simple as just bringing cookies to one party. We have a lot of people in our life that we have to show up for. So it's not just one of these going on, and then you finish that, get your cupcakes, awesome party, and then you do another one. It's all going on at the same time. And maybe in, you know, one thing that happened that you felt some brokenness, maybe you're really close to the Cookie Monster cupcakes. Maybe in some of them, you still feel really broken. Maybe in some of them, you've made it a little bit worse in some way. And that's okay, that's life. Life is not as clean as, you know, just one thing that we can put on a screen. And so you're working through this. Say that you get to this point of resilience. Do we agree that we want the Cookie Monster cupcakes for the party? Okay, just making sure. There's a problem with resilience, and that's that those cookies still had to be broken. And if they're not just cookies, if they're a person, being broken hurts. And so resilience is really great, and it ends up being really helpful, and it ends up feeling really good. But that doesn't mean that when you get broken, it doesn't really hurt. You still get punched in the face. And anybody who gets punched in the face goes, oh my gosh, that hurt. Even if it's a little thing, most of us, when that happens, it hurts us a little bit. And that's normal. That's okay. That's living. That's being, you know, a person. And it takes that brokenness to get to resilience. You can't make the Cookie Monster cupcakes unless the cookies get broken. There's no other way to get to resilience. You might be able to get back to where you were, maybe, but you would throw out some good time and money and cool things that you could make something better out of. You might could get back to a place of a whole cookie. But it's pretty impossible to get to a place of resilience where you go, I'm so much better than I was. I'm not just bringing cookies. I'm bringing Cookie Monster cupcakes to the party. That place requires brokenness. And again, there's a lot of psychologists that have their various theories. There's a creativity guy called Dabrowski that has a theory that says, in order to ever go up, you have to disintegrate. He calls it positive disintegration, meaning to get to a positive place, disintegration is required. And we should not look at disintegration. We should not look at the brokenness as a negative thing. Does it hurt? Absolutely. But is it necessarily a negative thing to be broken? I don't think so. It's definitely hard. But we know that we're going to be broken as human beings. That's a given. And if we can make something even better out of that, that's pretty fabulous. So I wonder if I could get some help from a couple of people. Hi, I'm Amelia.
Ivan,
nice to meet you. Could you hold on to this? Can you stand up for me? Hi, I'm Amelia.
Hi, Ryan.
Ryan, nice to meet you. Could you stand up and hold on to this? So now the rest of y'all are like looking at your shoes going, how many more people are gonna get dragged into this thing? Glad we didn't sit in that row. And when you start practicing resilience in your own life, the people that you're closest to that hold some of the string in your life, they're close enough to be holding on to your string. When you start being resilient and you start moving, man, I should have picked girls. Then you start pulling them. And at some point, they have to take a step forward. Y'all can let go, thank you. And the people who are closest to us are the ones who end up doing that. We're pulling them into a place that they're uncomfortable being. So the people who are closest to us, who we would expect to really be supporting us, sometimes are the people who are least supportive. Sometimes are the people who say, I don't think that's a good idea. Sometimes they get a little grumpy with our moves toward resilience because they're in that relationship with us. They're holding on. And so when we move past where we normally are, we make them move too. And most of the time, if we're moving to a place of resilience, eventually they'll catch on and go, okay, this is really cool. But really often in the beginning, the people a little bit less close to us are like, man, that's really cool. Like, you're doing a cool thing. And the people closest to us that we count on for our support when we do crazy things, like try to be resilient, the people we count on for our support are the ones being the least supportive. But it's not because they're being the least supportive of you and your resilience. It's because you're making them wobble a little bit and they have to sort of catch their new footing and go, okay, I see it now. It's looking good. But usually you have to give them that time. And it's a little bit backwards because usually when we do something really cool, we expect the people we're closest to be our biggest supports, yeah? And usually when the people who are really close to us are not supportive and we're doing something crazy and unknown and scary, that hurts. That can create its own new sense of brokenness, yes? It's not that those people are not being supportive. It's that you've got to give them just a little chance to find their footing again, to figure out where they're supposed to be standing right now. They usually do catch on, but you've got to give them that time. So I wanted to watch a little video clip.
So we're going to stop now. What Amelia does next is she shows a clip from the movie Sister Act. Some of you may or may not know that movie, but it has to do with a choir singing, and they're singing very differently than they usually sing in a very joyous way. And there's a lot of grumpy looks from the audience. And she was using that as an example. So now I want to go back to the PowerPoint. So here, and I have to correct myself because I said cookie monster cookie. I should have said cookie monster cupcakes. So anyone have any thoughts they want to share out loud or put in the chart about Amelia's metaphor about cookie monster cupcakes in terms of a metaphor for resilience?
Diane, this is Wesley.
Yes, hi, Wesley.
Hi. It seems to me that Cookie Monster is beloved by people of all ages as a very upbeat, kind of carefree, mm-hmm. fun creature. And so there's that. as opposed to any other face you might want to make. And then, you know, needless to say, out of brokenness, including the brokenness or the elements of that, making a very enjoyable, fun, likable thing.
Yes, thank you, Wesley. Yeah. And anyone else want to share?
Joan Steinhouse. I have had stroke that I've been recovering from for 20 years and getting stronger and stronger as I have gone along. And I had aphasia. I could hardly speak at all. It turns out my vocabulary has gotten better as I've I'm using the $50 words that I didn't ever use before. And even beyond that, I've gotten so I've gotten to love words so much that they're just a beautiful tool in general, and I've become like poetic when I never really was before. So that's my share.
Thank you for sharing. You are a Cookie Monster cupcake. So to go on with the journey of Amelia. So Amelia emailed me July 30th with this message. With some encouragement from strangers at Arches National Park, I made a video of some of the last month out here listening for my soul. I wanted to share it with you. It's been such a time of healing, and your groups have been a bigger than expected part of that. Amelia was deciding at that time whether or not to continue medical treatment or to be in hospice. She went on in her email to say, literally, either a life that feels like death or going toward a death that feels like life, all decided on the unknowable of my body and our healthcare system. It's heavy, but I'm at home within myself either way. And that is overwhelmingly peaceful. I guess the video is my art this time. P.S. The fox actually came. She had sent me a picture of a photo of a fox. The fox actually came right up to join our last group with Zora. So I left in a hurry when it and my dog started barking at each other. Amelia was talking about poet collage artist Zora Hussain, who facilitated the Shape of Grief July special event as part of Follow Your Arts Heart. So Amelia's video is titled Amelia and Lulu. Lulu is her dog. On the YouTube posting, there's also the title Hold On Tight. But before playing the video, I want to first share with you the lyric to the song that is so much a part of the art's rendering. And the song is Keep Breathing by Ingrid Michaelson. And I will read it. The storm is coming, but I don't mind. People are dying. I close my blinds. All that I know is I'm breathing. I want to change the world, and instead I sleep. I want to believe more than you and me. But all that I know is I'm breathing. All I can do is keep breathing. All we can do is keep breathing. Now, 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 now. All that I know is I'm breathing. All that I can do is keep breathing. All we can do is keep breathing over and over now. So what I'd like us to do at this point is I'd like to play for you the song. And if you'd like, as you're listening to the song, you could do some drawing or writing. Imagine if you were dancing to this, how that would be. Somehow respond. And even if that response isn't outward, but inwardly, to respond creatively to the song. So what I'm going to do now is to stop this share and do another share where I find the song. And you'll be able to see the lyrics too, because this is the lyric video. And again, if you could give me a thumbs up that you can hear the song. Oh, I'm sorry, here. And now I'm going to share with you Amelia's video that has that song in it.
Beautiful. Look at that. A black and white.
Good, good.
You're such a good girl. Good girl.
Diane, thank you so much for sharing that.
Oh, thank Amelia.
Yeah.
So I don't think we have time to share this in the group, but in your remembering that, you could write or draw your response to Amelia and Lulu, which she also called Hold On Tight. And if Amelia could have been with us here today, what would you have wanted to tell her about how her art touched you? And if you want to, and I'd like you to, if you could, to share that in the chat. On August the 7th, just last month, Amelia sent a separate PS email to me with photos. PS, a phoenix I Dremel carved from a broken Texas lightning well I picked up in Galveston in February or March, since I know you like phoenixes. The phoenix is a mythic bird of regeneration, right? It's only one phoenix in the world, and it sets itself on fire and is reborn from its own ashes, a symbol of resilience. And these were the beautiful phoenix, right, that Amelia had carved. Email me again that day and referenced my having asked her to present on resilience for your art's heart, and an Ernest Hemingway quote I'd sent to her. That quote has to do about being strong in the broken places. And she said, "I'm so touched to be asked to speak, but need to see what happens with my health. If we do start hospice and not do another critical care admission at my level one, I probably have less than 2 weeks before death. Oh. If things stabilize again, yes, 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 2 exclamation points. I've been thinking a lot this week about strong at the broken places. I'd forgotten the rest of the quote that I sent her. Thank you." On August the 13th, Amelia posted her poem video, "The Day I Knew." She wrote the poem in February 17. She wrote in the posting's description section, which was back in February, "Apologies, I never got to do real editing as planned." And now I want to show you her "The Day I Knew."
I had too many questions, so I came to the ocean, to my mother, to my church. Yesterday, I told it I was sad, and the ocean waves lapped quietly. She asked the sky to paint a beautiful pink-orange sunset, and they comforted me and held me, not frightened by my sadness. I talked to my doctor yesterday. My phone sent me a notice of the referral to palliative care. Today I came back to the ocean and told it I was angry and overwhelmed, and the ocean crashed its waves hard into the shore, the outside matching my inside, a validation deeper than a human can give. She threw shells on the beach, so many, that they clattered together as the waves rushed in. As I picked them up, she told me that sometimes anger is the right emotion. I told her that I was scared that my life should mean something. She told me to look down at my footprints in the sand, and as I did, she sent a huge wave far up the shore to erase them. She told me it is okay. It is the way of life. I walked and I told her how broken I feel. She told me to look down and I saw the thousands of broken shells she was throwing at my feet. She told me that brokenness is the way of life, that many animals die and the shell of their life also breaks, that it is okay if all I leave is also broken, that sometimes it is the way of life. I told her how much she had helped me, but that I had stayed too late and I had to hurry home. Rather than goodbye, she asked me why the fish do not try to live on land, nor the rabbits in the ocean. She told me that you must live where you are meant to, that some people cannot be safe, trapped inside, on the phone, doctor, hospital, insurance, repeat, that I must be true to my nature. Even if it might kill me if I am away from the hospitals, I asked. She told me that when I came to her this week, she saw that I was already dead. She told me that a shorter life is not bad, to remember that I need not create anything special to have lived well, that usually the most beautiful shells in life are equally broken in death. She told me that I can live now at peace, that I can live wrapped in the arms of my mother, this ocean, crying with me, singing hymns.
So some reflections or thoughts on her beautiful poem video. Are you grieving the loss of a loved one? Are you grieving for yourself? And where do you go for comfort, for validation, for understanding? Who or what helps to contain and share your emotions, your sorrow, your brokenness? What does the way of life mean to you? And have Amelia's words touched you? And if you'd like to, you could put some of your reflections into the chat. Amelia emailed me again on August the 26th. And shared that she was admitted to hospital, to hospice. Amelia also sent me her Phoenix poem that she'd written in March 2022. I emailed Amelia that same day. I said to her, "My heart goes out to you. And may your journey be one of peace. Is there anything you want me to share of your creative works and thoughts on resilience through the Flower of Peace online creativity journal as parting gifts from you with love, Diane?" And Amelia replied that same day, "So far, yes, peace. Feel free to share anything from my website or Instagram or what I've shared with you all. Share that resilience isn't the buzzword we've made it and does not ever come without struggle and brokenness. Share the cool story of how Garmazi even invented resilience as a construct hunting down traumatized but successful school children, about George Bonanno's coping ugly. What does that mean for each person? And how do we give ourselves grace when our coping is outside the accepted norms? And definitely share this Phoenix poem thing from spring when it was very unsure if my body was trending towards life or death. often our phoenix has to burn to move forward. So here is the image of the phoenix and also Amelia's writing, which I'll read to you. The ashes have become wisps of flames this week. It's messy in the swirling fire and ash. Hot, sweaty, dirty. I'm not sure if I'm crying or if it's the heat and soot burning my eyes. As the flames have grown this week, they only look like increasing destruction, identical to wildfire flames on the news, leaping everywhere without direction, making sure I don't quite know which way to run. Today, the flames started to take shape, first a tail, then the tips of what looked like several primary flight feathers on what might be a bird's left wing. The vision of a bird emerging from the flames is becoming clearer now. She is already strong and almost in flight, her flames lighting up the sky for herself and for those around her still in darkness. I can see almost half of her body now. She is too strong to have a reason to run. She is too bright to hide. She is completely vulnerable to attack, as is a snake who has just shed its skin. But it's undeniable. Those flames are organizing into the powerful form of a phoenix, and she is ready to fly. I'll read the last paragraph again. I can see almost half of her body now. She is too strong to have reason to run. She is too bright to hide. She is still completely vulnerable to attack, as is a snake who has just shed its skin. But it's undeniable. Those flames are organizing into the powerful form of a phoenix, and she is ready to fly. My reply to Amelia that day was, may the phoenix that you are burn ever brightly. Love, Diane. On Thursday, September 22nd, I received this email. Hi, Diane. This is Bayo, Amelia's wife. I tried to update as many people as I could, but not sure if I missed you. Amelia passed away on September 1st. Thank you for making an impact on her life. In Texas now, and this is true, at this very moment is Amelia's celebration of life. She died September 1st. Amelia was 39 years old. And knowing Amelia through her creativity and in a way, miraculously being able to share about her today with you, I thought of the quote by John Donne. No man, no woman is an island entire of itself. Every woman is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less, as well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or of thine own were. Any woman's man's death diminishes me because I am involved in humankind and therefore never sin to know for whom the bell tolls it tolls for thee. And here's Amelia again. In Texas, Sunday, today, 3 p.m. I also thought in terms of Amelia's creativity and in a way being channeled through me today to you, her spirit. I thought of this poem by Emily Dickinson. If I can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life the aching, or cool one pain, or help one fainting robin unto his nest again, I shall not live in vain. Amelia had eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis, EGPA. It's a very rare disorder. It was not rare for Amelia. There's a short video about EGPA on the American Lung Association website. And if you go to the American Lung Association or look up EGPA, you can watch that video. I think Amelia would want us to know about the illness so we can help ourselves and others who might have potentially EGPA symptoms. I'm wondering, since EGPA, it's a vasculitis, it's an autoimmune disorder attacking multiple organs. One of those organs can be the lungs. And I don't know if you could hear that she was out of breath after the hike. You could hear her, the heaviness of her breathing. And she chose the song, Keep Breathing. And I wonder if that had some special meaning for her in terms of also the illness that was taking away her breath and her struggle to hold on to keep breathing. And here's a beautiful picture of Amelia. I have this quote in my home on the wall, given to me actually by my mother, had it. And I thought it was apt to share with you. It's by Henry Drummond. It says, I shall pass through this world but once. Any good, therefore, that I can do, or any kindness that I can show to any human being, let me do it now. Let me not defer or neglect it, for I shall not pass this way again. I want to thank you for being with me today, memorializing, honoring Amelia. And also, I think, being true to the title of this presentation, that actually I thought of this topic months ago, and very miraculously, synchronicity, serendipity, it came together in terms of Amelia and her work on resilience and how she wanted to be able to present to us, and she has presented to us. I also want to let you know that there is an online journal called Flower of Peace that I'm developing through the Arts and Healing Resiliency Center. It's a wellspring journal for creativity, hope, and human connection, and that the poetic or art offerings are inspired at the workshops and special events. Just as each flower blossoms in its unique and fragile, yet strong beauty, we share our creative gifts with you and the world. And I will be sharing Amelia's artwork in the journal too. And if you want to be in touch with me in any way about creativity, resiliency, healing, or you'd like to contribute to Flower of Peace, my email address is Dr. Diane at mindmatterspc.com, which is DRDIAME at mindmatterspc.com. I know it's 2:30 now. And I have to say that it's another miracle that everything that I wanted to share with you fit in within the time allotted, because this wasn't scripted. I wanted it to be real. And I'm very grateful that everything that I wanted to share with you has been shared. If anyone feels comfortable sharing what this experience was like for them, you're under no obligation to do that. But if you'd like to, we have a little time for those who would like to share. And if not, if you'd like to put any of your reactions or thoughts, reflections in the chat. The reason why I recorded this, because not all of the presentations or workshops are recorded, is because I'm going to be sharing this recording with Amelia's wife. I think it'll be meaningful for her. Bayo had shared with me the presentation, and she also shared with me the video of the day I knew. So I think it's going to be very poignant, but also very beautiful for Bayo to see, you know, this presentation.
Diane, this is Dr. Wesley Brown.
Yes, hi.
A very moving, especially with all the circumstances, you know, which, you know a lot more about, but a really, really meaningful, what a loss that she wasn't able to pursue further, you know, all her creativity and everything that was building in, you know, and she seemed so young and was so young, I'm sure, just everything, just starting out, huge loss. Will you be, journal, is this something, will you be like posting that gradually, like in sections as it develops online, or are you just going to wait until you sort of got it all collated, you know, and everything gathered?
Wesley, what I've started to do, is like one time, right? Is that on the Arts and Healing Resiliency Center Facebook page, I've started posting people's, one person at this point, writings. And a part of it too is that since I'm looking for contributions that have also been inspired through the workshops, that to talk about, you know, person to give a little bit their own background, which workshop was it, what inspired them, what they're hoping someone else might, you know, benefit from in viewing it, and then sharing the actual work. I have there's someone else that had contributed to me. I'll be sharing her work, and I'll also be now sharing Amelia's work as well. So what I'm thinking is that as I have more people sending me their creative offerings, then I can put it together more as a full online journal. I hope that answered your question.
Yes, it did. And one other, Diane, was it through some of the workshops that how did you first encounter Amelia, or she encounter you?
Yeah, well, Amelia somehow must have been looking on Eventbrite, and maybe because it's called the Arts and Healing Resiliency Center, and she's a resiliency expert, and that's why she joined the group. And she must have been in the group, I'm thinking, and some people right now that are participating, that they met Amelia through the group.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of times, maybe three times, right?
Yeah.
Three or four times. And she was always in her van, right? She was an active contributor in the chat. She would respond to people's writings or in the group itself, talk about how other people's writings moved her.
That's wonderful.
So that's how we came to know each other.
Yeah.
And so we met each other in a creative space.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Kind of heart to heart.
Yes. Yeah, it definitely comes through. Yeah.
Thank you, that's Wesley.
You're welcome. Thank you, Diane.
Rochelle, do you want to say something?
I didn't realize that she was sick when she was on that one Zoom and I offered her to come to my house and stay. So she was homeless. And I wish she had stayed in touch with me because I had no idea. I mean, she never related. She was dying or anything. I mean, I'm just so very emotional today because of that. Plus it's Rosh Hashanah tonight. And just emotional time. Anyway, but her thing on resilience really, really, really hit home. And I'm really glad you shared that. I'd like a copy of that because it was, I think that would help a lot of people. Some of the stuff she said in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I will be posting this video on my YouTube channel. And what's it called? Arts Medicine for Hope and Healing. I think that's the
name. Just give me the name, please.
Yeah, the channel. And I'd like to share this presentation with others because I think Amelia has so much to share and offer. Right, I thought her presentation was fantastic, and that the metaphor of the cookie. I think we can all relate to that, and her poetry. Is so profound and so generous.
Yes.
Generosity of her spirit.
I had given you that suicide in London, that suicide prevention site in London. They might be interested in that stuff.
Yes. Yeah.
I don't know if you still have it. If you want the information, I can give it to you again.
Okay. That would be good if you could send it to me. That would be good. Yes. Anyone else want to share? And I'm going to just show you one last thing too.
Where's her wife living?
I don't know. I know that the memorial is in Texas today.
Oh, I wish I knew. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So this is also part of the creativity journal. And this flower originally without the red was an artwork done by Manza Musa. Manza is an artist friend that I know from New Jersey. Fantastically talented man, multimedia, as it were, creativity. And I had seen when he had posted that flower, and it was at the very start of the war with the Ukraine. And I asked him to add the red and to add the colors of the Ukrainian flag, and that was part of the inspiration for the online journal, because I was also thinking to link it with sites where people could make donations to worthy causes. And I paired it with part of a poem that I had written that I thought matched it. And I think in a way that poem also speaks to the poetic in the presentation today. And that excerpt is, "So tender the flower in peace, being and becoming is its beauty. And oh, the blood these thorns have drawn, I struggle for where a flower does reach." So I want to thank everyone again. There will be another monthly special event, and that will be posted on Eventbrite. And if any of you want to reach out to me in any way, you know my email address, and you're welcome to, before we close, to put anything else into the chat. So I'm wishing everyone a wonderful rest of your day, and I hope to see you again in a month. So I'm waving goodbye to everybody. Bye.
Bye, Diane. Thank you.
Bye, Diane. Thank you. Bye, bye, Raquel. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Thanks for
Thank you, Diane. Thank you, everyone.
We need everyone to join. Thank you.